good afternoon. It's good to see everybody. It's, you know, a lovely spring day out today. So we're back to part two for the ugly truth behind mass incarceration and recidivism. And we're so glad to have all of you here this afternoon. I see a lot of old friends from our first part that we did, and I also see some new friends today, and I'm excited about seeing our new friends today. For those who don't know, my name is Gail Carr Williams, and I'm Associate Director of Community, Neighborhood, and Government Relations here at Vanderbilt University, and I am just pleased to have all of you here with us today. And I think we have a very engaging panel coming up, a little bit different than the last one. We're sort of taking the journey a little bit further in terms of what happens in this whole system of mass incarceration. So I'm excited about that. And I also appreciate the fact that many of you all sort of sent us an evaluation back. So as a result of that, it helps us to do better programming and programming that more meets your needs. So thanks again for doing that as well. And for this program, I want to thank Chandra, who's in the back, for her work. And a lot of this planning of this program was sort of out of Chandra. She sort of came up with most of the ideas for this program and a lot of the implementation. So I really want to give her a huge shout out and really congratulate her on some really great work, because I think this is a great program. So way to go, Chandra. Yay. And she ordered our lunches and gave us her name tag. So it's all that. And Carol, who's out in the back, that's helping us. And also Midori Lockett, who's here and part of our team that helps us to plan these food for thoughts. So without further ado, let's get on to our conversation. Project Return, Betty, thank you so much for coming to us to ask us to engage in this partnership. Appreciate it very much. Charlotte, thank you very much for sort of bringing your past experience to us to be able to do this. It's been really fun, and I think we've learned an awful lot. So thanks to both of you. So, panel, are you ready?
Ready.
Oh, it's ready.
Ready.
Ready, set, go. Here we go. So our moderator for today's panel is Professor Lisa Gunther from philosophy. But she's sort of interdisciplinary, and some people put her in sociology. I don't know who that could be. And next we have Samantha Williams, who is a 3L law student here at Vanderbilt University, going to graduate in a couple, three more weeks. Something like that, huh? Yay! I'm sort of kind of proud of her. I wonder why. It's good. Thank you for being here today, Sam. Also, we have next to Sam, we have Stanley Reynolds. And Stanley is a Project Return participant and is also a full-time machine operator at a local manufacturer here in town. So, Stanley, it's good to meet you today and glad to have
you
here with us.
Thank you.
Betty Kirkland, who is the infamous director of Project Return and has been a mainstay in the Nashville community for human rights and a multitude of other things. We're lucky to have you to be part of our community, Betty. And next to Betty is Judge Sheila Calloway, a double Vandy grad. And she anchors down. Does it get any better than that? And while she is a double Vandy grad, Judge Calloway is doing some absolutely amazing things with our young people here in Nashville. I am so proud and sometimes just in awe of the work that she does every day to make outcomes and lives better for young people in our city. I think her vision and her commitment and her passion to make the world better for young people is great, and we're lucky here in Nashville to have her. Thank you, Judge Calloway. And Professor Noble, who is in sociology. Well, Professor Noble, I've known you for a long time. He, too, is a Vandy alum that has come back to be a faculty member here at Vanderbilt. And just recently, Professor Noble was appointed as the director of the Bishop Johnson Cultural Center here on campus, which is very exciting. What a great opportunity for Bishop Johnson. I mean, you know the Vanderbilt story so well. And you have supported students, our minority students on campus, and other students as well, for all the years that I've known you. Almost enough years for you to call me Gail. And in addition to that, he will be one of the heads of house at Steinbaugh House on our commons, which he and his family, his adorable family, are going to be able to lead that effort, and that is just a great asset for Vanderbilt. So to all the panelists, I thank you, and I welcome you, and I appreciate it, and go get it.
So our panel today, last time we met, we discussed youth incarceration, the school-to-prison pipeline, and some of the pathways that lead people into prison. And this time we're going to discuss the other side. So what does it mean to come out of prison? What is the recidivism rate in Tennessee? What are some of the barriers to reentry and some of the factors contributing to recidivism? And how can we support people who are coming out of prison to flourish and to re-enter our community and contribute to it? So I looked at the governor's task force on sentencing and recidivism in order to prepare for this panel. And this was a report that was issued in 2013. And it has some pretty shocking statistics about recidivism in Tennessee. So our recidivism rate is 46%. That means that within 3 years, 46% of the people who leave prison will return to it. But I think that this recidivism rate can, if you just look at that alone without looking at the context, it can be a bit misleading, because 40% of admissions to the Tennessee Department of Corrections are for parole or probation violations. They're technical violations rather than the committing of another criminal offense. So the procedures and policies that we have around parole and probation are a very strong contributing factor to recidivism. And I think we need to keep that in mind when we look at those stark figures of 46% recidivism rates. Now, if we look across the South, Tennessee's incarceration rate is a bit anomalous in terms of our southern neighbors. Other southern states have seen their incarceration rates go down and their crime rates go down. Tennessee has seen its crime rate go down slightly, but its incarceration rate go up slightly. So our incarceration rate increased by just a small amount, 0.4% in 2013, but other states like Alabama, Mississippi, and the Carolinas saw their incarceration rates go down. And if you look at the average, if you look at the 10 states with the largest decrease in incarceration rates, you also see an average of 13% drop in their crime rate. So incarceration rates going down and crime rates going down. So I think this governor's task force on sentencing and recidivism gives us kind of the numbers, but we need more context from our panel and some of the personal experiences of people who have been in prison, who have come out of prison, and who work with people coming out of prison to give these numbers some meaning. So I want to get us started off by asking Professor Noble and Judge Calloway and whoever else wants to contribute to giving us a little bit of context about what drives recidivism rates, what are some of the challenges that face people when they come out of prison, and so how do you make sense of that particular problem?
I think I'll start off. One of the classes that I teach at Vanderbilt is a class called Prison Life, where for about the last 15 years, I take a group of students on five or six different occasions throughout the semester, and we actually go visit different facilities and learn about the ins and outs and so forth. In addition, my research is on prison systems, so I've kind of studied the prison system there as well. But one of the things that's alarming to me as it pertains to recidivism is the lack of, I guess, substantive rehab programs that we actually offer inside the facilities themselves. In a lot of ways, what we essentially do is what I would classify as warehousing, where there's not a lot of real substantive rehab opportunities that we provide for individuals. Most treatment programs we can think of in two capacities. One in terms of being something that's internal focused, where you're working on this person internally, be it anger management, substance abuse, parenting skills. But then externally, we're thinking about what types of skills and trades are we providing for these people so that when they actually are released, they're able to be successful. And what I've discovered from my own experience and as well as with the people that I interact with who still come and actually speak to my class after the fact, is at this point in time, I've gotten to know several people will come and share their experiences after they've been 15, 20, 35 years in prison. It's the fact that, to an extent, we may be somewhat heavy on the internal side, and that's relative depending on where you are. In terms of where you are in the state, there's certain facilities that do a better job. And unfortunately, most of that is volunteer driven. And when it's volunteer driven, meaning that when their resources dry up, it dries up for inmates on the inside as well. But we offer very little what I would classify in terms of external, where we're teaching people tangible skills and things that can actually translate into job opportunities when they do get released. And my own anecdotal evidence, what I've seen is that the people really tend to do well. They maximize everything that the facility has to offer, which typically isn't much. But then they also have a network of people that they can rely on when they get out. And that network of people may be family, it may be folks like Miss Betty at Project Return, but you have to have something more than, you can't rely simply on what you acquired inside the facility, and you hit the gate at day one, and you're gonna be successful. There has to be this huge network of support services that either come from family and friends or agencies such as Project Return, Dispatch House, Next Door, any number of different agencies that I've interacted with on a number of different bases. But based strictly on what you have in the facilities themselves, the recidivism rate doesn't surprise me. I'm actually surprised it's not higher, is what I was saying. And as a statistician, I question numbers all the time, so I would probably question that number as well. But that would be kind of my skill. And part of it is like in terms of what feeds recidivism, the lack of what we don't do on the inside. And even basic things, see, Constance is one of my colleagues when I was at Tennessee Department of Labor. And when I was at Labor, one of my many hats that I wore was the reentry coordinator, which was a fancy word that I liked to throw around and say we had a prison reentry coordinator at the Tennessee Department of Labor. But they didn't give me any resources. Every project idea that I came up with, they shot down, including one of the ones that I thought was really valuable was we have these huge vans that they call Tennessee Career Coaches. And these vans are equipped with state-of-the-art equipment, all sorts of stuff that you can actually drive these vans into correctional facilities. Inmates could do any number of job opportunities type stuff within that on this van, and then the van kind of goes back and goes to its next location. Well, I typed a proposal to where we will work with the Department of Transportation to essentially allow inmates to retrieve their driver's license. Uh-huh. So we could put together a packet of material of things that they could do on this coach. And one of those things would be that when this person left that gate, they had their driver's license. Because the driver's license is a big thing in terms of being actually employable and making sure that you can verify who you are. They sent me on this statewide tour to do all this stuff, and nice proposal, and at the end of the day, it's like, we don't want to do that. So I think another part of the problem is that we have some key players in state government, local government, who don't get it as well. The importance of the various ways in which, as a system and as a state, we can do a better part and make sure that people don't come back as well. So.
Uh-huh. Thank you.
And I'll add to that, first I'll talk a little about some of the barriers that I see in some of the adult cases that we handle, and then barriers I see as our youth, and for our youth that are trying to get back into society on the same footing. But one of the things that we do, there's a law that if you father a child, then you have to pay support for the child. And a lot of times, if a father goes to jail, they are still required to pay support. And what I determined to do as the judge and kind of advise my magistrates that work with me, that while they're in jail, let's suspend that amount because they can't make payments. So what we were seeing is that we were seeing that gentlemen that went into jail that had a child support order, and let's say your order is $200 a month, and you're in jail for 10 years, and that 200 a month, 200 times 12, times 12, times 12, times 12, when you get out, your child support debt is well over $100,000. And so you're coming out of jail, and there's absolutely no way, you know, even if you have worked with Project Return or any of our other agencies that work to help you get a job, there's absolutely no way that you're gonna be able to pay this amount. And what the state will do, and what the courts don't have any authority of, if you are significantly behind on your child support, they can take your rights to have a driver's license away from you. And so you come out of prison, you have a $120,000 child support bill, they say you need to pay us a lump sum of $10,000 or we're gonna take your driver's license. I don't have that. So you take your driver's license, so legally you can't drive and you don't have any other way to do it, transportation is something that we have to work on in Tennessee, particularly in Nashville, so you can't necessarily get back and forth without driving. You get pulled over, and then what happens? Then you're right back where you started. And so we have a system that keeps people down, and it prevents people from ever trying to get out. And so what I try to do is encourage my magistrate to suspend those payments during that time period while someone's incarcerated. And then there was a very recent Supreme Court case that said you can't even suspend those payments. And so technically, and I watch how I say these words, technically we can't suspend them, but sometimes we might reserve them. but you know, when we have a higher court that's saying you can't even do this to help somebody out, you know, it baffles me tremendously why we can't do things that we know, or why we do things that we know are really going to hurt people. And on the youth side, one of the things that we don't do well is we don't help youth transition back to homes. And so if they're locked up, whether it's for 30 days, whether it's for 6 months, whether it's for a year, we are encouraging counseling between the parents and the child, and encouraging visitation, but we're not teaching the child and the parent together on what happens when he gets out. What do you do? What friendships do you have? How do you supervise them? And so they learn a lot while they're in a structured environment, and then as soon as they go home, it's a different environment. They're back exactly where they came, and we didn't put in enough effort to make sure that when they get out, they have the same tools and they can use the same tools to be able to be successful. The other thing that we don't do well is while youth are locked up, is we don't require much education for them. And so, as I stated the last time, education is the key. And if, as we see the statistics all the time, if children are not in school, not graduating, the likelihood of them ending in the criminal justice system is extremely high. And so what I have and what I see on a regular basis is children who may be removed from a school setting for 30 days or for 60 days. But if you imagine if you miss 30 days or 60 days of school, when you go back to school, how far behind are you and how can you get re-engaged into the school process? And so our state law does not require students who are in detention facilities to have education. And so there's recently a case about Rutherford County in Solitary where kids were being locked up for 23 hours. They're not getting school. And so when they're getting out, and these are 14, 15-year-old young people, not usually men, that are not getting education. And when they're getting out, if they're going back to school, they are that far behind. Our state does not require education for those children. Now, on the other hand, the state does require education for students who are in Department of Children's Services custody for a lengthy period of time. So it does require that, but the qualifications of that type of education are not equal to the qualifications of a regular high school or a regular middle school. And so you're not getting the same quality education that you would if a child was in the community and going to their regular zone school. And then when they come out of these facilities and they're placed right back where they started from, we're not doing anything to transition them and to help them to have a smooth transition. And so, again, we are, as a system, starting the whole incarceration process all over again.
Mm. Wow. So
did I leave it on a tamper?
That's a low, but
yeah,
let's start building up from there to hear from Betty about some of the work that Project Return does to support people coming out of prison to find and to build those networks of support that both of you have said are so important for their flourishing on the outside.
Yeah, you create a big job for me. but a couple of things that you all have said I just want to pick up on. One is the lack of rehabilitative services in the prisons. I'm old enough to remember when there was a debate about should we be punitive, should it be deterrent, should it be rehabilitation, and you know, the news is that punitive kind of won out about 50 years ago, and the die was cast, and here we are. And so what we see now, in part, now that really everyone recognizes that mass incarceration is a problem and that everyone recognizes we've got to do something differently, there is a way in which the incarcerators, the government incarceration systems and the private prison systems and so forth, are, it sounds like, maybe tacking on to this punitive thing a whole reentry piece. And I guess my message to that would be just build in rehabilitation. The reentry happens when people get out. The reentry is done best in other ways, but just bring rehabilitation into the prison. Teach reading, teach math. We have a guy, Michael, who did about 20 years in Tennessee penitentiaries. He didn't ever get his GED or anything. He got out. He was doing very well for several months, and then on a parole violation ended up getting reincarcerated, and at that point he was in a county jail, not Davidson County, but in an outlying county, which frankly felt like 1940 when I went down there for the hearing. But at the hearing, the judge told him, clearly your record shows you're learning disabled, you can't do this, you can't do that. After that hearing, he went on in that jail setting where people kind of got to know him and support him. He went on to get his GED. He passed all the sections of it and sent us a photo of him holding his certificate. And what that, while we were thrilled for him, of course, what that also said was, what were we doing during that 20 years in the pen with nothing? So the rehabilitation piece would be transformative in itself. However, if you look across the country, truly it's mostly on both coasts, although Project Return is doing it here. For large impact, large scale, large number organizations that are helping people be successful after they get out of prison, it's not government system reentry programs. It's not private prison system reentry programs. It is independent sector, non-governmental entities that have the innovative flex, the business mindset, and the ability to really make change for people in their lives. I'm thrilled that Stanley's joined us today on the panel, and I'll talk a little bit, though, before he gets to, about what Project Return does. When someone gets out of prison and wants more than anything else to get their life on the right track, Project Return is here for them. There's really nothing about addressing mass incarceration that can be effective unless we address the issue of the throngs of people who are returning to us. When they return to us, there's no neutral. There's no neutral. Either it goes badly and they get reincarcerated and they become that statistic that I also think is higher than it sounds, or they are successful and they don't go back in and they become another member of our community doing well and thriving. And so it's one or the other. And so I've not met anyone, I'm really gonna think about this, I've never met anybody who gets out and says, I'm gonna try to commit another crime so I can go back in. Frankly, the only time that we do hear people talk about that possibility is when they're reflecting on how hard it is out here. How hard it is out here. And so how hard is it? Employers reject people on the grounds of their criminal background roundly. And so Michael, for example, gets out of prison. He's in some far-flung state penitentiary, and so he's getting released. He gets put on a bus in the dark of night, a little before midnight. His bus lands at the Greyhound station on Lafayette Street before dawn. He gets out, and Michael, who I'll just cut to the chase and tell you, is a thriving, wonderful person at this time and going forward. But at that time, he gets off his bus, and he has nothing. He has $22 in his pocket. He has the set of clothes that he's wearing. He has no cell phone. He has no ID. He has no place to go, no place to live. He has no job prospects. It's hard, I think, to even imagine that, but people are doing that every day, hundreds every week getting out of state penitentiaries here in our state alone. Michael, fortunately, came to Project Return. We're conveniently located up the hill from the Greyhound station. With Michael, we start right away. The first thing we do is welcome him as a person of worth and dignity. our work is nothing if it's not about relationships. And speaking about relationships, right now and every day, some of my coworkers are out building relationships with potential employers, because that's where we find the connections that we can make for folks around employment. But for Michael, we had to get job ready right away. There's no time to waste. We call it the fierce urgency of now, to quote from Martin Luther King, but we've kind of skewed it to fit our purposes. He needs to be job ready. He needs to be making eye contact and shaking hands and talking about his life experience in a way that's appealing and fair to himself. He needs to lift that shroud of shame and find his best self, just like you and I do every day. But he also needs food. He needs clothing. He needs bus passes. He needs his ID. He needs for us to pay for him to go over and get him in right away to the clinic to get a medical exam, to get his teeth cleaned, to get his eyes examined, to get new glasses. All these things that we're catching up on that were deferred maintenance, I guess, maybe. But most importantly, we're connecting him with employment as soon as possible. And so that's really the key. It's the number one predictor of his and everyone's crime-free future is that employment. So that's our main focus. And there's much more to know about us. You can find it online or in the materials that are outside of this auditorium. But that's kind of in a nutshell what we do.
Great. Thank you, Betty. Stanley, could you talk a little bit about your own experience with Project Return and coming out of prison and reentering the community?
Yes. When I got out of prison, I was just like Michael. I had nothing. You know, I had no family. I had nowhere to go. I had nowhere to stay. So I ended up at the mission, you know, at the men's mission. So I stayed there a while, and I was going to a staff zone, you know, just to work, have some money in my pocket. And that was working out all right, but it was kind of cold, and I don't really like working in cold weather. So, you know, I heard about Project Return, and but I didn't know where it was because I wasn't familiar with the streets. I had been locked up, you know, for 8 years. So when I got out, I was asking people, where's Project Return? Where's Project Return? So finally, I just took off walking, looking for it myself. And I found it. And, you know, and so I walked into it. And they explained what they do for people. You have to go through a program and, you know, to get involved. So I done that because I wanted to do something for myself. So I went through the program. I went through the courses, the classes, and then after I did that, you know, every time I needed something, they was there for me. So, you know, they would give me a little booklet to go out and find me a job. So like Miss Betty said, people that's own business, they don't really want you to work for them because you've been incarcerated. So that was hard for me. You know, it really was. So I just ended up, you know, getting bus passes, going out looking for jobs. And so it didn't work, so I just went back to staff zone. So anyway, Project Return, you know, every time I needed a favor, I would go to them, and they was there for me. You know, they like family. So anyway, Christmas Eve, you know, I got a little intoxicated, got loaded. And so I said something out of the way to one of the volunteers at the mission. So they burned me out for good, you know. And I said, hey, you know, I was loaded, you know, I was... So anyway, I ended up on the streets. I had nothing. I was sleeping on the outside. I didn't have nowhere to stay. It was cold, you know, Christmas Eve, it was cold. So anyway, I graduated from sleeping on the streets to in empty houses, you know. And so anyway, I went to Project Return, and Mr. Chad, he said, man, I'm gonna get you a job, you know. So he got me a job at Nashville Work. So I was proud of that, but I was still homeless. I was still sleeping on the streets. But I would get up and go to work, you know, because I know that was very important to me. So anyway, I got the job. I kept the job, but I'm still homeless. So Mr. Roger Collins. You know, I was his client, you know. So anyway, I told him, I said, man, I'm tired of sleeping on these streets. I'm working, I'm going to work every day, but I'm just not comfortable sleeping out here on these streets like this. I said, I'm gonna save my money. If I save my money, could you help me find a place? He said, yeah. So I saved my money, And I got me a place now. I'm off the streets. So anyway, man, Project Return had been like a family to me. You know, if it weren't for them, I don't know what I would have done. I probably would have ended up back up in jail. But they are, it's the best program in the world to me. And they got the best employees up there. The people are so nice, it's crazy. You know, but anyway, man, I love them. I love Project Return.
Love you too.
Love Project Return.
I do want to add, you said 8 years, but you did a lot more time.
Yeah, I did a lot more time.
When
I was 15, I started doing time. Most of my life, I've been locked up. Most of my life. And when I did a lot of time, I'm talking about really a 20-year sentence, you know, I got out of prison, and I was lost because everything was different. When I went to prison in 1992, you know, it was just back in the old days. But when I got out in 2005, everything was different, and it scared me, you know. And I was really thinking about going back because I wasn't used to being out here, you know, in this freedom. But anyway, like I said, I held on, you know. I prayed, and like I said, Project Return turned my life around. They really did. If it weren't for them, I don't know what I would have done. But anyway, I'm still with them. They still with me. They never gave up on me. They'll never give up on me. And they'll be my family for life. I love them so much. I really do.
Thank you so much for sharing your story with us.
You're welcome.
Sam, can you talk a little bit about your work with Project Return as a volunteer?
Oh, yeah.
And
certainly.
How that has affected your life.
Yeah, so I am a volunteer at Project Return, and so I've been doing mock interviews and speaking with some of the participants kind of about what I do and kind of how they want to, as a law student, maybe things we can do to help the population that has returned from prison. And it's been extremely rewarding for me. I think it's probably the best experience I've had volunteering. As Stanley said, Betty and the volunteer staff, including Charlotte, they are remarkable, and they really do care about everyone who walks through the door. And honestly, I don't think I've ever seen an enterprise like that in my entire life. Just the hard work that they do and the care they put into all their participants as well as their volunteers. But it's really, it does feel like a family when you walk in, like Stanley said, and they really do a wonderful job. For me, it's been very transforming because I've kind of read a lot of stuff about mass incarceration. I've read about the recidivism rate, but here it actually really puts faces to these numbers, and that these are people who are in our community. And as much as we would help people with, I don't know, anything that we would want to do in our community, we should also be helping these individuals in our community because they bring so much to our lives, and they, as Betty said, they deserve respect and they deserve our helping hand. And for me, it kind of, you know, we kind of talk about, I think the stats that you gave about kind of like recidivism, you know, it's not just people committing a crime, or it's not just people wanting to go back. It is a lot of technical things, and it's a lot of people who unfortunately did get poor representation and continue to get poor representation from people. And so it's not as, for me, it laid it out to see there are so many gray areas with what happens to people who come back to jail or who have trouble finding work. Like Stanley said, a lot of participants have told me, I don't have any family out here, and I kind of come out here on my own. And to hear people's stories and to hear just how challenging it is, it's inspiring to know that these people don't give up, and they really do fight because they know that, as a quote that I really do like, it's from Brian Stevenson, who is, I can't remember the name of where he works, but he's does a lot of work with Equal Justice Initiative. He says, we aren't defined by basically the worst mistake that we've made in our lives. And I think that's what we should all live by. You know, I've made mistakes, but sometimes the mistakes, the stakes haven't been as low for me, and for other people it has been as high. It's been much higher, and I don't think people should be defined by that, and we should always give people a second and sometimes third, fourth, fifth chance until we can help them reach their full potential. So Project Return has really kind of changed my life in a way that it has opened me up to looking at people differently, and also really realizing how much work needs to be done and how Project Return is really on the forefront. So if anyone wants to volunteer, please do sign up. I will give a good pitch. It's a great way to be involved with the community.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you. So now we've heard from all of our panelists. I'd like to open it up to some more general questions. And one thing that I'm curious about, I think I have a little bit of a sense of what a parole and what would constitute a parole or probation violation that could put you back in prison, but could people fill us in, anyone fill us in on, like, what does that mean in practice? Does it mean, like, you miss a parole hearing or a meeting with your probation officer and that will land you back in prison?
It can be missing a parole or probation meeting, 30 years, failing the drug test. It can be you're in proximity of a school. I'm sorry, I didn't have control over that part. It can be missing a meeting with a parole officer or probation officer, what they call dirty urine, you failed the drug test or you didn't submit to a drug test. You were in a location where you shouldn't have been. Part of your probation orders or parole orders was a list of do's and don'ts, and you can't be in certain proximity of school zone. You were found in certain proximity of school zone. There's a litany of various things. It can be something as simple as leaving without permission. I have a cousin who was on parole in Illinois, and when his brother graduated from Tennessee State, he couldn't come to the graduation because his parole officer didn't give him permission. He came anyway. Technical violation. So it's like, it can be, there's all sorts of do's and don'ts, and it's a litany of things. And Ms. Betty, maybe every time, there's some additional ones as well.
Well, I did think of, I know a guy who, there was an affidavit put out on him based on a charge, or based on testimony of someone who said he had done something. So he was jailed immediately, but when that went to court, that was dismissed. But having gotten a charge is a violation. And so he then had to do around about 12 or 14 months of prison time on that violation for the charge that was dismissed. So that's a kind of an example of how it can go.
I even know another guy who comes and speaks to my class. He's what they call a lifer. Mm-hmm. He made parole with a life sentence. And he has a card that he has to carry in his wallet at all times. And if he's ever stopped by the police, that has to be the very first thing he gives them. If he doesn't give them that, that's technical violation. So he can't just, hey, here's my driver's license. Oh, I forgot my card at home. Uh-huh. That's technical violation.
Wow.
Stuff like that.
So that really brings up some of the stigma that surrounds having done time. You know, like, we tend to think on one level that if you do your time, then you have paid your debt to society, and that should put you back on equal footing with anyone else. But clearly that's not the case. If you have a card that you have to show police officers first off that says that you have committed a felony and that you have done time in prison, then you are you're being branded for the time that you did. And it seems like that stigma also attaches to poverty and homelessness, and there's a connection between the stigma of doing time and the stigma of doing, of not having the wherewithal, the economic, financial wherewithal to keep up with the sort of payments that are expected of you that Judge Calloway talked about. So I wonder if we could talk a little bit about the way that stigma is a barrier for people looking for employment when they get out of prison, and some of the campaigns like Ban the Box campaigns that have arisen to try to reduce that stigma and remove that barrier.
I want to add just a little on what they were just saying a few minutes ago. When you talk about the technical violations from probation and parole, and one of those is you have to pay your parole fees and your probation fees. So you have to get a job, you have a certain amount of time, you have to get a job, and you have to pay your fees and your fines.
And your child support.
And your child support, yeah. You've got to pay all that. And so you talk about the business of incarceration that doesn't last just while you're incarcerated. So and where these fees come from is for every day that you're in prison, you owe the state a certain amount of money. And so you are racking up your bill. And so when you get out, you owe this amount in fees. And then you have, on top of that, your incarceration fees that you're responsible for paying. You're also responsible for paying your probation fees. So it costs money to be on probation or to be on parole. And so there's a fee for that. And so, and then on top of the court fines, and these are statutorily court fines as well. So every time you come to court, as a judge, and if I check the box, and you owe court costs. So if you come to court on and you're trying to get your license back, and you file a motion to get your license, that's like a $50 court fine cost. And so every time you step in, if I continue the case, because this attorney's not ready or because the witness is not there, that goes on your court cost fee. And so the amount of money that people owe when they get out is just a small stigma. It's a huge amount, and it doesn't help the system whatsoever. But if you're not keeping up with your fees and your costs, that could be one of those things that actually places you back in incarceration as well.
That's amazing. So, Roosevelt, you would like to say a little bit more about that?
Not about that part. I was going to take back the stigma, but if you want to chime in on that one, I had something about the stigma.
Could I just ask a follow-up question to that? So what is this incarceration fee? Is that kind of like room and board that you're expected to pay for the time that you've been in prison? Or?
That's
actually why. I've had some inmates that told me, they advise family members, don't put a lot of money on my books. Because if you put a lot of money on my books at a certain threshold, the state starts taking. They can start claiming some of that while you're in.
Wow.
So if you want to give me $200, send me $10 money orders 20 times versus dumping $200 on my books.
Uh-huh. Wow. And then that in itself involves fees for the family members sending them multiple times rather than sending one time and a larger amount. Wow. Stanley, do you have something?
I can do that.
For all of us.
All right, testing 1, 2, 3. All right. A lot of the stigma part, though, the one thing I would say about that, I think that is a big one that a lot of times general society we don't think about. Ms. Betty, you've come to my class a couple of times, and the main objective that I preach to my kids from day one is to meet people where they are and not where they've been.
Right.
And I tell them, if you're one of the fortunate people that incarceration hasn't touched your life, at some point in time it will. And don't wait until it touches you personally to start caring about it. And meet people where they are and not where they've been, and try to get them to see that. You guys are Vanderbilt students. You're going to go on and be legislators, employers, CEOs, whatever. You're going to have the power of basically life and death in some cases, because you're sitting down trying to make a decision if you want to hire somebody, and you've observed that they check this, yes, I have a prior felony box. And one of my objectives in that class is get them to understand that I've introduced you to some good people. One of them, who I like to brag on, is an individual who got out in 2005. I met him in 2002 when he was on the inside. When he first got out, he had a tough time getting a job. He was in on first-degree murder charges. You don't get a whole lot of callbacks when you put first-degree murder on a job application. But when he put on there, yes, prior felony, willing to discuss, 1979, and this is 2005, well, Eagle Global Logistics, the primary shipping company for Dell, hired him. And it wasn't until 3 years later when they were considering promoting him for a supervisor that ever even came up. And he's still there today. He's married, drives a Cadillac CTS, just bought a house last year. And I tell my students all the time, this is a person that was a lifetime, had a life sentence. By statute, he could still be in prison, costing you $35,000, $40,000 a year. And he's, for the last 12 years, he's voted in the last, got all of his rights back, he's done all these phenomenal things. But at the same time, if you just met him on the street and he told you, I spent 24 years at Riverbend as an accessory to a first-degree murder charge, we all kind of jump back. And I pose the question to the students in the class. A lot of times I say, let's suppose you went out this weekend and you met a great guy or female, and they were just the perfect match for you. But on the second date, they told you, hey, I got to explain something about my past. For the last 2 or 3 years, I was in prison. How many of you are going out with the second date? The hands drop rapidly. And that's what, by the end of the semester, I hope to introduce you to some people that will cause you to kind of step back and question that. Because if all of us who are law-abiding folks decide, I don't want to hire you, I don't want you living next door to me, I don't want to interact with you, well, who do we leave them to interact with? What options do we leave people? And I personally care about this because I have family members that have been caught up in the system. And Vanderbilt students are not immune, because I've had some stories that have come to me as well from some of my students as well, that don't wait until it touches you personally, but we got to realize that we all play a part in making sure that individuals like Mr. Stanley has success upon release.
Yeah. So we've talked about some of the economic barriers, but you just brought up another barrier to reentering into the community as a full citizen, and that is getting your right to vote back. Could one of our panelists, maybe Stanley or Betty or Sam, talk about what it takes to get your voting rights back after you come out of prison?
Well, I'll just say that Tennessee is one of the 12 worst states in the nation in terms of our readiness and willingness to give people their votes back, and so it's extremely strenuous. We provide a voting rights analysis to every one of the hundreds of people that comes through our office to let them know what would have to happen, what could we line up, what are the prospects for you getting your vote. And so far we've had, since we started doing that about 10 months ago, or maybe, yeah, something around there, because we were getting all excited about the presidential election, we were able to get two people so far to get their rights back. It's extremely difficult. I'm not going to really quote the law to you, but it's just very, very high bar. Have you ever voted, Stanley?
No, but I know it's true what you just said, because I remember they brought it to me about it, that I could, you know, start voting, but I just never gave thought to it.
Yeah.
And does that cost money as well? It's a long administrative process.
You have to pay all your fees. So these hundreds of thousands of...
Absolutely. So
no,
if you owe any money to the state in any way whatsoever, whether it's child support, that's my big issue, if you can tell, whether it's child support or anything, probation fees, you are not eligible to vote.
So, like, I have a mortgage. Like, I don't know how many people in here have a debt, but if we all had to be debt-free to be able to vote, it's kind of like that.
Amazing.
So you have to be finished with all your time, your parole, your probation, all that has to be done, and then you have to have your fees paid off.
So here in Nashville, we had a ban the box movement that I say in the past tense, but it's not completed yet. It's still very much alive, but the ban the box movement did have a victory in making Nashville Metro jobs, please correct me if I'm wrong, having the job application for Metro Nashville jobs remove the question, have you ever been convicted of a felony? Could some of our panelists talk about the importance of that kind of reform and the impact that could have if it were more broadly adopted?
I think, I know talking with some individuals who I volunteer with at Project Return, they say kind of that it kind of reduces the stigma and they will actually kind of go out and apply for more jobs. And when you see it, it can be kind of defeatist. And I've read articles about that too, about people when they see it kind of on a psychological end, they feel, oh, this is not a job for me. They're not going to hire me because they're going to know that. And they're going to pick applicants over that. So I think from a psychological and maybe like a confidence standpoint, it gives people more confidence to want to apply for different jobs. Because I know when I speak with some of the, when I do the mock interviews, we go through a part where it talks about what experience do you have. And someone will say, I remember with someone who's like, I used to own a restaurant, I manage this, I manage that, but then became defeated when talking about, oh, I have to maybe have to check that box so I can do something. But it's like, you have more experience than anybody, most of the applicants applying, go ahead and apply, but still it's that, it kind of deflates the confidence a little bit more.
Right. Stanley, when you got your current job, did you have to have a conversation about that, or were you able to... did the job application ask you to disclose if you had a felony conviction? Or do you remember?
Well, really, no, because I got my job through Project Return. You know,
that's great.
Yeah,
right.
they helped me get the job. But I never filled out the application or nothing, you know, because I work through Pro-E. It's a program.
Okay.
So, I've been on the job now about 3 months. So. A couple of weeks ago, I filled out my application, you know, to get hired permanently.
Yeah.
So I haven't heard nothing back from it. They're waiting on my background check. Uh-huh. But anyway, I know you do have to go through a process, though, you know, before you get hired on. Mm-hmm. But I'm doing pretty good on the job, so I'm looking to be, you know, permanent in a couple of weeks.
That's great. Yeah. So that's one of the ways that Project Return helps people to navigate the system of finding jobs in this situation where if you didn't have that assistance in that program, you might have to battle with that box.
They had the hookups, you know, to get you hired. Yeah, they had the hookups.
It's important.
Yeah, so we talk to employers every day who they have workforce needs. They need employees. And we have motivated job seekers. And so you would think the conversation would just zoom forward from there. But it doesn't. And so what we do is hire people ourselves to bridge that, I'm not going to call it a gap, I'm going to call it a chasm, So if we become the employer of record and we become the transporter and the supporter and the payer of wages and really all things and provide that workforce to that reticent employer, that reticent employer 3 or so months later says, how soon can I hire Stanley? You know, Stanley is working this job and I want to hire him. And so it's a it's been a helpful process and we're thrilled about it. So yeah.
I think another good thing for employers, which I'm sure Ms. Betty can educate people on, but when I was at the Department of Labor, part of my job was actually meet with employers as well. And trying to educate them about this is not a great one today, but, trying to educate them about things like the work opportunity tax credit. Most employers don't know you can get, actually get a federal tax break for hiring somebody that has a prior felony. There's a federal bonding program, where you can, which is basically an insurance program that you can purchase if you hire somebody that has a prior felony. It's like an insurance program that you can purchase. But part of those kinds of initiatives was part of my job as well, was educating employers on kind of minimizing some of their perceived risk and hiring somebody who has that particular stigma. Because in the absence of that, you know, there is this wall of sorts that comes up. And one of some of the saddest calls that I ever had was, and I just share one little anecdotal story, a person who called me at the Department of Labor one day who, when he was 18 or 19, did something to cop some type of felony. Went to work at a factory job for about 30 years. The bottom falls out of the economy in 2008. His company lets him go. He can't get rehired now because everybody keeps doing background checks. And what a lot of people don't realize in the state of Tennessee, TBI goes back 51 years.
Wow.
TBI, when they do a background check, they go back 51 years. And I had to call TBI myself to verify that because I was like, that still came up because the common conception on the application says, have you been convicted of something in the last 7 years?
Uh-huh.
But when the job market got really, really tight, they were pulling misdemeanors, they were pulling anything, whatever, that came back was grounds for, we don't want to touch this person.
Right, wow. We're going to open things up to questions from the audience in just a moment, but I'd love to hear from each of the panelists one thing that you think would help to address and remove some of these barriers to people reentering. What is your vision for restructuring the system that we have that puts up so many roadblocks in people's way and opening up that passage of reentry? Dr. Noble, can we start?
My vision would be the services that Ms. Betty offers,
Yeah. Coupled
with equally as important, equally as demanding, equally as significant programs happening on the inside.
Yes.
I think so often we ignore what happens on the inside and we kind of meet them at the gate. And if we can kind of do a better job of getting them while they're in and then meeting them at the gate with the services that they offer, I think it would be great.
I totally agree. We got to have true rehabilitation while someone's in, and in importance on giving people education as well while they're in, and then helping them to transition when they get out, and providing that support, that family, that person's going to take them to their next job interview, that person who's going to do whatever they can, helping them to each build their own network. And I'll just say, our philosophy for parole and probation is totally backwards, because we say to people who weren't able to follow the rules for whatever reason, okay, we're going to take you away from society, we're going to structure you, and we're going to throw you back out. And by the way, those same rules, we're going to have a whole bunch more on top of those, and if you violate any single one of them, you're done. And so that absolutely makes no sense whatsoever. The way we do probation and parole is crazy. I was going to say a bad word, but it's really backwards the way that we treat people who are on probation and parole.
Just a few years ago, I saw a news story about a woman, an American woman, who was overseas in a foreign country and was abducted, and she was held hostage for months and eventually released after deprivation and fear and just terrible situation. The story was really about her return, and I was mesmerized by the care and the thoughtfulness that was taken by the people who helped her come back. I think it was probably some governmental State Department or something, but it was a recognition this woman had been through this extended trauma, and they were bringing her back, and so she was coming home to her husband, and they were careful how they structured their time together and careful about introducing her into America and into her own household and gradually getting on her sort of psychological feet, really. And I think that the reason that we don't feel that way as a community toward the people coming out of prison is this just hard-nosed sort of I shouldn't say hardness, but really a failure to recognize that they're people, and they're coming back after a period of deprivation and difficulty, and that debt that we determined has been paid, stamped paid, and it's going to be difficult. So let's embrace, let's support, let's not shut out, let's open up. And I think that just seeing people as human beings would be my vision until we get that rehabilitation going too. Like, it really needs to be something serious, important, intentional, and wraparound to embrace people.
I think a community should give a person a chance like me if I just come out of jail or prison and look at me differently. I'm not the same person I was 8 years ago. You know, I'm matured. I was younger. I made a mistake. I paid my debts. But today the community don't look at it like that. They won't let you forget the past, you know, and that really hurts when they won't let you forget the past. So then you feel down on yourself because, you know, they won't let you forget the past. But anyway, I think people should give you a second chance. At least try to get to know the person today, not 8 years ago, but today. You know, and I think it'd be a better world if everybody would do like that.
Yeah, I'll just kind of second everything that was said and just add kind of what Stanley was saying, you know, just have empathy for people and put yourself in their shoes. Like you were saying, Stanley, you know, you're not the same person as you were when you went in. And think about if you were to do the same thing and you had to go to prison, the things that you would lose during your time and the debt that you have paid. Maybe it's not a monetary debt, but you're paying time that you don't have with your family, skills that you could acquire, and it's a debt that's not really measured by money. And so when people pay that forward, kind of put yourself in their shoes and kind of take a step back and realize, if this were me, how would I want to be treated?
Thank you. Questions for our panelists? Yes.
I'm hard to hear, so you haven't spoken about the need for change inside the prison as well as outside. Talk is cheap. My question, are you aware of any people, organizations, programs that are working to change, and I'm talking about successful programs, and if so, what are they?
That's a good question. One of my favorite programs that are on the inside is a program called Men of Valor. Men of Valor is at, I hate where they're based, but they're based out of CCA. But Men of Valor has a program that's kind of like it's a faith-based submersion program almost, where as an inmate, when you come in, you're held in a separate pod, so you're not in general population. You're there for the entire time. You have free world mentors who would be individuals such as myself who would come out and meet with you on a weekly basis while you're in there. You get a heavy dose of scripture. You get a heavy dose of like anger management, all these various internal training programs. When you're released, they have a community, they have a housing apartment complex where you can go and you actually stay in a similar community. I would continue to meet with you as your mentor who helped you on the inside. I'm helping you get a job on the outside. That to me is the best example of a heavy dose of services on the inside coupled with, they're gonna meet you at the gate and literally drive you to this community. We'll keep these wraparound services on the outside to help you get employment and eventually help you get back on your feet. I've met several people that have gone through Men of Valor and have been successful. Now, in terms of duplicating that in the state, the whole issue of church and state, so there's certain restrictions, which is why we don't see it. I will say the last time I went to Lois DeBerry Special Needs Facility, however, a state-run facility, I saw the Men of Valor folks in the lobby. So I was like, I don't know if they're planning to do something, but that to me is, so there's examples, just not enough large-scale examples of where that's being done. And definitely not from the state.
From 501c3. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yeah, there's definitely. But from a state government or an entity, I haven't seen a whole lot. And I've been in every prison in the state of Tennessee from some place that I wish I was never actually at.
There's also a program started by Bard College that does a lot of stuff in New York prisons, and they give college classes to inmates. I think it's still relatively new, but that's one thing that they're doing to kind of give inmates education and also let them, not just like the basic GED education, but also giving them more well-rounded kind of college education so they can see different things that they could potentially be part of and other interests.
And David Lipscomb does that here in Nashville. Mm-hmm.
That's right.
One of my favorite inmates, Centoya, I was going to call her Sequoia, with me. Centoya recently graduated from Lipscomb with her associate degree and is working towards getting her bachelor's degree. And hopefully she'll be out soon and will have at least her bachelor's degree and able to, she's an extremely bright young lady that went into prison when she was 15. So. She will be out and be a wonderful addition to our society.
Yeah, and in addition to the Bard Prison Initiative and the LIFE program at Lipscomb, the Inside Out Prison Exchange is a nationwide network of colleges and universities who teach college classes in prison, ideally with an equal number of inside students who are incarcerated and outside students who are not incarcerated and who are enrolled at the college or university. And ideally everyone comes out with an associate's, or with college credit and or an associate's or bachelor's degree. And also some prison entrepreneurship programs have been very successful. We had a pilot project here in Nashville, but this is across the country. And yeah, there are other programs as well. I think we have time for one more question.
I don't know about a specific expunged charge. In most of the cases that I've dealt with, the charge had never been expunged when they found it. So I don't know about expunged.
Yeah, it's really important when you get an expungement to hold on to that paperwork, because that can be the only proof. Particularly when background checks are done through private companies, my understanding is that the charges, just the convictions continue to show up for the foreseeable future. So it is an issue. I mean, it's important to get the expungement if you can, but then you have to kind of prove it.
And I'll say the expungements always stay on the police records. And so for the court record, it's gone. Like, I can't go and find it because it's gone. We have done our stuff. We send it to the CBI. We shred all our stuff. And so the court, if you came to the court and got it, you could not. But if you went to the TBI, then it would be there. And so you'd have to show proof that your record was actually expunged.
Well, there's so many questions and issues. We're 2 minutes over. Is this a quick one?
It wasn't a question. It was more of a statement. I heard Stanley speaking of the stigma.
Yeah.
From my experience of going into Riverbend and just fellowshipping with inmates that have come out, the one thing I would like for all of us to understand, and I know this may ruffle a few feathers, but we're all the same. The difference between us and quite a few insiders, they got caught and we didn't.
Like that.
There are so many of us who have done things that think that it's, you know, something small, but those small things that we've done, like steal a game ball. I put people in jail for 10 years. You would never, in your mind, think that would happen or could happen. But it does. So when you start to think of it that way, understand, like Stanley said, give them that chance, or give them that extra chance, or that third chance, because we're all not perfect. We have all made the same mistakes. We just did not get caught.
Yeah. Thank you so much for that. Let's give a round of applause.